Good morning, everyone. This gathering has convened to commemorate the second edition of Dr. N.R. Madhava Menon National Parliamentary Debate. At the onset, I would like to acknowledge the honor and privilege that the Society for Literature and Debating has in being able to host such a large-scale tournament despite the trying times. This tournament is a sign of hope as students continue to persevere and engage in what brings them joy and knowledge. Without further ado, for the welcome address, I would like to call upon a dignitary without whom this competition would not see the light of day, our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Dr. S. Surya Prakash, sir, to share his words of wisdom.
Good morning to all. This is my privilege and pleasure to invite all to the second edition of Padma Bhushan Professor Dr. N.R. Madhava Menon Memorial National Parliamentary Debate. And today we are privileged to have none other than Professor V. Vijay Kumar, Vice Chancellor N.R.I. Bhopal. Sir, thank you very much for your kind consent and accepting our invitation. Professor Kumar is the one of the founder faculty of NLSIU Bangalore and who has very long association with Professor N.R. Madhava Menon. So, very glad to inaugurate the second edition of this national parliamentary debate. Here, I would like to say a few words about Professor N.R. Madhava Menon. And in India, every student of National Law University is well aware that today NLSIU is number one, but for Professor N.R. Madhava Menon, who happened to be the founder vice chancellor of National Law School of India University, Bangalore. When the legal education was facing difficult times in many aspects, when there was a challenge to improve the standards of legal education, the challenge was accepted by Professor N.R. Madhava Menon, who was a professor of Delhi University at that time, and who was also secretary of Bar Council of India Trust, and who has started the journal India, who was also the editor of Indian Bar Review. He has visualized this five-year law course, that is BA, LLB, Honors Integrated Degree. And when he proposed this idea, mooted this idea with the Bar Council, he then chairman of the Bar Council, the members, they asked, because this is your idea, why don't you implement it? So then Professor Madhava Menon, he took this as a challenge and against all odds, he established the National Law School of India University at Bangalore. Initially, it was started with a humble beginning car garage in the Bangalore University. And today it's number one law university in India and also considered as Harvard of the East. So my friends, we are very happy to before last year, Professor N.R. Madhava Menon has passed away, and in his memory, he was decorated with Padma Shri, and posthumously, he was also awarded the Padma Bhushan, the one of the highest civilian awards, and he is the only law professor who was awarded with this Padma Bhushan by the government of India. So he has spent more than six decades in legal education. He was the father of modern legal education, because today, whatever the national law schools in India, or you may call national law universities, all of us owe to him, because it was his vision and because he who has contributed for the national law university movement in India. So he has given a turning point to the legal education in India. So we are glad that this university, DSNLU, is conducting the National Parliamentary Debate every year in the memory of a jurist, a visionary, a true Karma Yogi, Professor Dr. N.R. Madhav Menon. And then coming to the second aspect of this, this is a parliamentary debate. So as you know that there are so many forms of government, and the most matured way of governing the people is democracy. And in democracy, the parliament is the soul of democracy. So parliament reflects the will of the people. Parliament reflects the culture of the people. Parliament reflects the traditions of the people, the values of the people. Everything, parliament means it is a mini India, as far as India is concerned. So people from all walks of life, from all religions, regions, because they representing the different constituencies. The primary objective of a parliament is to discuss, to debate the problems, the issues of the people, of the nation, economic, political, social, everything. Everything under the sky is subject of debate. And the best form of governance is the democratic form of government. And I said that it is the collective wisdom of the parliament which will make the laws. So every law is the need of the time. So the laws governing the people, they are made by the parliaments. So a healthy democracy, healthy parliament is very much necessary. So to protect our freedoms, to protect our rights, so everything, a nation's future depends on its parliament. So we have so many parliaments, and particularly when we think about parliament, when we discuss about the parliament, obviously we have to think about the great parliament, that is the British Parliament. So the best parliament, Britain has produced the best parliamentarians right from Edmund Burke, and who has described, if you go through the proceedings of impeachment of Warren Hastings, where he has considered at the end of his speech, he described the English Parliament, which has an eternal fountain of inviolable justice. I impeach him, I impeach him, I impeach him. So when Warren Hastings was impeached, he described the British Parliament as an inviolable fountain of eternal justice. So justice ever flows from a healthy parliament. And not only that, in 2018, if we have observed, Michael Bates, the member of House of Lords, he was late to the sessions, just a couple of minutes, maybe some 60 seconds and another 62 minutes. And already at sharp, the question hour was started, and Bates, he was not present when the first question was posed by another member of Parliament, House of Lords. So promptly, he apologized, and also he has resigned his membership in the House of Lords. So what he has stated is that in order to maintain highest standards of democratic values, and to quote, he said, Bates, we should rise to the highest possible standards of courtesy and respect in responding on behalf of the government to the legitimate questions of the legislature. So the opposite benches, they have right to question, and the treasury benches, they have the responsibility to give the reply. So even in Britain, the House of Lords, it was the highest judicial body. That is, till the Supreme Court was established in 2005 in Britain, House of Lords, it was the highest appellate authority, even for judicial, in for all legal issues or legal matters. So we are proud that India is also one of the largest democracies, and a very vibrant democracy, and very active democracy, and all activities and all kinds of debates that is going on in the assemblies, state assemblies, and also in the parliament. So we are glad that the coming generations, they should know what is the importance of parliament, and also they should know how the questions, the parliamentary procedures, the survival of the democracy. The key to democracy is the parliament and the healthy debate. So today, I am very happy. I welcome to this wonderful program our chief guest, Professor B. Vijay Kumar, the Vice Chancellor, NLI Bhopal, my registrar, Professor Madhusudan Rao, and the faculty in charge, Soma Bhattacharya, the students, the teams participating from different states. And also I'm glad to note that there are teams from Bangladesh, the teams from Malaysia, teams from Ethiopia, teams from particularly Japan. And this debate has, this competition has attracted students from different countries. And I welcome all of all the teams, the team members, and hopefully next time when we conduct, normalcy may be restored, and we may have your physical presence in our beautiful university and in our beautiful city, Visakhapatnam, on the east coast of India. In particular, I welcome all the teams who are participating, and the objective is to know, to learn, to have the necessary knowledge how the parliament works in a democratic system, the importance of parliament in a democratic country. Undoubtedly, in a democracy is the most matured way of governing the people, and we are fortunate because we are in the civilized nations, and civilized nations always opt for democracy. With these few words, I welcome all of you to this competition, and thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. Okay.
Thank you, sir, for your kind words filled with knowledge, and for reminding us of the sheer eminence of Dr. N.R. Madhava Menon, his vision and his legacy. Now, I yield the floor to Ms. Soma B., Assistant Professor at DSNLU, and our amazing faculty advisor, who is the cornerstone to the society and competition.
Mani, I'm going to introduce the program to all of you. DSNLU is proud to announce Professor N.R. Madhava Menon National Parliamentary Debate. It is in honor of his stalwart who has strengthened the legal education of the country. We have 80 participating teams, including 6 international teams. And these teams are basically divided in 20 rooms. Each room comprises of 4 teams, and each team comprises of 2 speakers. One speaker will precisely get 7 minutes to speak on the motion that will be forwarded by the core adjudicators, and the team will be judged based upon the understanding of the motion, the manner and methodology, what they have done, how they have put forward, how they have deliberated. Based upon that, the teams will be judged. Now, the unique line of this debate is that not only the teams will judge the core adjudicator, core adjudicator will judge the teams, but the teams will also judge the core adjudicator. It's vice versa process. So the competition will start precisely at 3:30. From 12 o'clock, the briefing session will go on. So it will start precisely at 3:30 with the preliminary rounds. And then there will be qualifying rounds. And after that, the culmination in the form of final on 6th of June. And then there will be a concluding ceremony. So those teams who have participated, who have made it a success, I wish them all the best and have a very happy debating. Thank you.
Over to you. Thank you, ma'am, for reminding us of the result the society has strived for. I know this competition will live up to its name. I now request Professor Dr. K. Madhusudana Rao, the registrar in charge, to enlighten the gathering regarding the importance of parliamentary debate.
Am I audible? Ramji, am I audible to you?
Yes, yes.
Yes, sir, you are.
Volume increase cheyandi. Increase the volume.
Good morning to all of you. Today, it's a happy day for us to know about the object of a parliamentary debate, the intricacies involved in these debates, and why parliamentary debate. At the time of framing the constitution, the framers of the constitution may have 2 to 3 objectives for the objectives for establishing, for writing the constitution, for providing the forms of governments. So the framers in India, they have provided a parliamentary form of government. The reason is, wherever it is, or which, in which country the constitution may be enacted, if a responsible government is to be established, then people prefer parliamentary system of government. When the parliamentary system of government is introduced, then the next question is, how the parliamentary debate should be? What is the legal structure provided for a proper debate in a particular constitutional document? Whether those things are relevant for the purpose of knowing the importance of the parliamentary debate. Supposing the parliamentary debate is not properly conducted because of for want of a legal structure, then what should be the result? So for what purpose the debate is to be conducted? Do we have any guidelines provided in this regard? Then once we say that the parliamentary debate is necessary, on what lines the debate should go on? Normally, the scope of a parliamentary debate depends upon the functions of the parliament. So broadly speaking, the parliament has the primary function of legislation, being a legislative body. So nowadays, the socio-economic system, day by day, is changing so fast, along with the development of science and technology. Consequently, these socio-economic conflicts are disputes requires a new legislation that is going to have its own impact on the society. For this purpose, a debate in the parliament concerning a bill for the purpose of enacting a law to govern a particular situation, known as legislatively, if it is to be dealt with, then the parliamentary debate is necessary to throw light on the requirements of the bill. Likewise, day in and day out, the governments are drawing money from the consolidated funds. It is here the importance of the parliamentary debate comes into the picture. It is the duty of the parliament to see that it must have control over the governmental finance also. In a democracy, what happens is the governments are endowed with exuberant powers to spend money as it likes. And unfortunately, we do not have sufficient guidelines to be followed by the government for the purpose of governmental spending. If a populist government is there, then the populist government starts spending money for populist measures. Consequently, development activity may be neglected. And how to control this public finance is the major function of the parliament. So the parliamentary debate must concentrate maximum on the control of public finances by the government. For example, we have one particular provision: no taxes without the authority of law, Article 265. Authority of law means here whether it is law as defined by Article 13, Clause 3, or whether it is a law to enacted by the state legislative organ of the state. So there are different views on this. Law in this sense means a law that is enacted under Article 246, read with Schedule 7 of the Constitution. So thereby, taxes can be imposed by the state only under the authority of law, means under the authority of the parliament or the state legislature, whatever it is. Secondly, we have appropriations. And the parliament or the legislative body permits the government to draw money from the consolidated funds for the purpose of governmental expenditure. At the time of drawing money or at the time of introducing these appropriation bills and finance bills, the opposition parties and the other members vastly controls the government in drawing the money and in requiring the money by the governmental departments. This is another task of the parliament on which the people who are participating in the parliamentary debate have to concentrate. Likewise, another most important function of a parliament is deliberation and discussion. Deliberation and discussion sometimes occupies more than 50 to 60% of the parliamentary time because of the behavior of the government in office. If the government started implementing the policies that are against the constitution, or if the government is implementing the policies that are against to the will of the people, popular will of the people, because we have introduced democracy, but the governments elected under this democratic principle are not popular governments in the literal sense. They are popular governments in the logical sense. Most of the government, somebody has submitted a thesis to Oxford University stating that all the governments in the democracies are minority governments, but not the majority government. So this is technically they have analyzed it. So whatever it is, the government start implementing a particular policy that is very often may be against to the constitution, or it may be against to the popular will of the people. In that instance, what the parliament has to do? The legislative debates or the parliamentary debates have to concentrate on the government to see that the government has to frame a proper policy to suit the country or the society. And the maladministration is the most important aspect which the parliamentary debates have to concentrate on. When a particular government has attained some majority and then forms the government, virtually there will be no restrictions on such government from practical point of view. Technically, we may have, or legally, we may have all these controls may not be permissible or may not be exercised for want of many things. Thereby, the government's in power, they are exercising a lot of discretionary powers in this regard, mainly in the expenditure patterns of the government. So the expenditure pattern, it should be on a developmental purpose and not only on mainly the welfare issue. If the government totally concentrates on welfare issues, ultimately it results in purchasing the votes for the next election with the governmental money. This is something which the parliamentary debates have to concentrate, and then they have to control the government in this regard. Likewise, what is the legal system or legal structure provided by the constitution for the purpose of proper parliamentary debates in our country? For example, we have Article 19(1)(a), 19(1)(b), and 19(1)(c). These are the lifeblood of democracy. And then we have the legislative privileges. The legislative privileges says that the legislatures are having certain privileges compared to other bodies. These are mentioned in Article 105 and 194. And these privileges ensures the government or ensures the legislatures for a free and fair expression of their opinion on the floor of the house. And proceedings of the house can be published by the legislature under the authority of the legislature itself. So this is the legal structure provided for us. for the purpose of proper parliamentary debates. So thereby, we have a sufficient congenial atmosphere for successful parliamentary system and parliamentary debates. How this system is going to achieve its objectives, that depends upon the people who are participating in these particular debates and the people who are elected to the legislatures. So with these few words, I congratulate Soma Madam Ji for conducting this program. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for educating us and those who might be unfamiliar with the importance of debating at the Parliament. Now, I would like to invite our guest of eminence, Professor Dr. V. Vijayakumar, the present Vice Chancellor of National Law Institute, University, Bhopal, a seasoned and accredited academician who has over 40 years of experience in legal education, to address our awaiting audience.
Yeah, can you hear me? Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Shivani, for coordinating the work. Wonderful. Dr. Surya Prakash, my fellow Vice Chancellor at DSNLU, Professor Madhusudan Rao, who just addressed on parliamentary debate, Madam Soma, participating teams, a very good morning to everyone present here. As I address the participating teams, I would like to make a few mention about the author or the person in whose name the competition has been instituted. Now I can go on for hours together to speak about him. This is not an occasion to recall everything, but I would like to make a mention about some of the characters that this legend left behind an impression on everyone, and more particularly in the faculty and the students of NLS Bangalore. I had the opportunity and privilege of meeting Dr. Madhav Menon on 30th January 1988. I was working as assistant professor in Presidency College, Madras, and at that point of time, 6 months ago, I joined Madras Law College. I saw the advertisement for the National Law School, and I was called for the interview, and that was the first time I met Dr. Madhav Menon in Indian Law Institute, New Delhi. I don't know that many people say that I have a resemblance of Madhav Menon, because when we had the faculty of Delhi, Law Faculty of Delhi, when they visited law school, they used to ask Dr. Madhav Menon openly, "Is Vijay Kumar your son?" Right? I don't know what resemblance that I had with him. I am not very sure, but of course, he was a fatherly figure for everyone, and I am not an exception to that. And like a family, members also fight with their parents, and I also fought with him on a number of occasions. But let me tell you that I learned a great deal during my tenure at the NLS Bangalore, not necessarily teaching alone, but in taking up different responsibilities. And Dr. Madhav Menon was apt example for a couplet written by Thiruvalluvar in Tamil. I don't know whether anybody is in from Tamil Nadu in the teams, they would understand possibly. That couplet goes like this: Innar idanal ivan mudikkum endraindu adanai avan kan vidal. When you translate that into English, one may not get the real meaning as it is, but the closer meaning is that you find out who is the leader. This is the first lesson of a manager. the manager should know, actually it is actually the king. The king should know. And here, you know, he was not a king. He was a manager, as a vice chancellor, as a director. So the job of the vice chancellor is to find out those individuals who can do what type of work and assign that type of work alone to them. If X is very good in doing Y work, right, you cannot give any other work to them. Of course, everyone is a teacher. That's a different story. Apart from teaching, it is also administration that plays a major, major role. And all of you will be surprised that the National Law School Bangalore had only 2 pupils for all the 8 faculty members, or maybe 10 faculty members, registrar and the vice chancellor put together. So they will attend to each and everyone, come back, and we did our own work. Today, you know, if you want a cup of coffee, we summon the pune. Till the pune comes, we don't even want to drink the coffee, right? We get things done through so many people, but that was not the luxury that we had. We knew how to do the work, and therefore he was a wonderful manager in getting things done. And for almost 11 years at the National Law School Bangalore, it is on record, anyone can go and check that, all the examination related records were maintained by me and Professor Malla, late Professor Malla. His handwriting was very bad, but he used to dictate and I used to write. And Professor Mitra coming and assisting us in and around whenever we were doing that work. So you can understand that apart from teaching, it is not that like you go and you know, say something and come back. And in National Law School, you know, the team, the 80 students, they were all devils. You know, just you enter the class, you just cannot come out with what you want to say. They would gather more information than what you know. And therefore, you should be always, all the teachers were kept on their toes. So after discharging 3 hours of teaching every day, right, minimum 3 hours of teaching, we always did this work, and we had enjoyed a lot in doing it collectively, and we learned a great deal. Let me tell you, for those 11 years, he never ever interfered in the work of the examination committee, right? And not a single complaint came to him, nor we left any scope for anybody to complain, right? Everything was transparent, and we did it on time, and therefore there was very little scope for anyone to go and complain, including the students. Those who failed, they all appreciated our effort, and that is the way for everything that we have done. The master was Professor Madhavan. If only he had interfered here and there, then possibly things would have diluted, and then possibly we wouldn't have done what we have done to that law school in the first 11 years of the first computer coming to law school. And then only we translated everything from writing to computerization of the records. And there afterwards, it was the job of a clerk, right? And we also withdrew from that. The second important aspect that we learned in the law school is punctuality. If he says that 10 o'clock, the seminar will begin with the introductory session, you have invited a judge from the High Court or somebody coming from the Supreme Court or some VVIP that we always invite, right? And 10 o'clock, all of us will be assembled in that conference venue. And 10 o'clock, if that VIP fails to turn up, whether he is a sitting judge, retired judge, a VAVIP, we never used to bother, and he never used to bother. And 10 o'clock, he will look at his watch and say, Vijay Kumar, can we start? Right? And we'll start exactly at 10 o'clock. And a couple of times, the judges also who came late, they apologized, joined, they tried to explain. But this, you know, finally, Dr. Menon would say, we maintain punctuality, right? And therefore, anybody, similarly, the classroom exercise. If anyone today things would have changed, I don't know. But if the class begins at 8:50, right? You can see 8:49, all the teachers will be keeping their attendance and waiting near the entrance of the classroom, each and every classroom. The moment the bell rings, all the teachers would rush into the classroom not even wasting a single second, right? And not like, you know, after the bell rings, you look at your time and say that it is too early or too late, and that is the time you discuss with somebody. Nothing would happen. Bell rings, the teachers are there. The reason is, if the teacher is not there inside the classroom in the first minute, you know, we senior teachers, we used to go around along with Dr. Menon. If no, the teacher was not present in the classroom, he would not even tell anything. He would just look at us, any one of us. At the moment, you know, he looked at us, we'll just enter the class and start discussing who is the teacher, what is the subject matter, and we start whatever little we know, we start discussing and what was taught in the previous class. And therefore, when the teacher comes, finds that somebody else is in the class, he or she would understand, okay, that Dr. Menon had come wrong and he had put somebody else in that place and gone. The third important aspect that I would like to mention is he facilitated what many law schools possibly would not have experimented, something called as cooperative teaching. And let me tell you, as a teacher, as a part of that teaching, Professor Malla, myself, Professor Devidas, and there was one Bhandari who was there for the first few years and left, and the last few years, Dr. Subbarao. Three teachers will always go to the constitutional law class, administrative law class, and in the initial stages, both in political science, legal methods, and legal history classes, right? So therefore, you could see that law is not single faceted. You have diverse views and opinions coming in. And what you are now going to do, the parliamentary debate, three of us will debate on the same topic, and we will not repeat what the other person has said. But respectfully, we would say that the views expressed by Professor Muller is taken, but I do not agree with it. And I don't agree with it for these many reasons. And then I say, what is my understanding? The third teacher will say, I don't agree with both of them for these many reasons, right? And he would give his own reasoning. So the students at the fag end of the class will have too many interpretations to handle. And sometimes they say, sir, we are confused. And collectively we say that if you are confused, we are successful, because you start thinking. And when you start thinking, you will find the answer. And our job is to make you think. And to that extent, he facilitated this cooperative teaching in the National Law School, which became the hallmark of the National Law School teaching. Today, there is no one to do that, because no two teachers can go together in any class, and they would not possibly even take opposite sides. And you know, and in fact, very jovially, we used to say, cooperative teaching has become a cooperative teaching. Cooperative cheating now. Because if you put two teachers in a particular course, they say, you take the first half, I'll take the second half, and they will not go together, right? You put three teachers, they will divide the topics, and they will not go together. That is not the intention. The intention of cooperative teaching is sending, you will be surprised in one constitutional course. As long as Justice Venkatramaya was teaching, there used to be seven people inside the classroom, seven teachers. And that too, which class? First year classroom, or maybe second year classroom, that's all. Giving on interstate river water disputes, amazing. We brought the chief engineer from the government of Karnataka to tell us the technical aspects. We understood everything, because reading by books, you don't understand anything, right? So therefore, that benefit, credit goes to Professor Madhav Menon, who created that atmosphere. The third important character that I appreciated was that if you are a drum, if you are committing a mistake, don't hesitate to apologize. The person to whom you have to apologize may be junior to you, maybe a student, maybe even an attender, right? You don't to apologize. But if you are at the wrong end, you don't hesitate in apologizing. And on many times, when you know, in law school, many things will happen. Many people will go and say something. So he would also say something. But when he gets to know that the information fed to him was wrong. He would be there at 8:35 in front of the room to come and say wish each other, good morning, Vijay Kumar. I am sorry. Yesterday I spoke to you like this. Right? That decorum, I don't think any leader will either appreciate it, or will any leader do it. Right? You do expect your vice chancellor to go to a junior student, right, or a peon, and say, I'm sorry, I scolded you yesterday. Right? That, I think, is the character of this man, Dr. Madhav Menon. He was not at all status conscious, and that he focused more on the institutional development rather than his own family. I'll just give you, you will be surprised to hear this from me. He had two children, one boy and a girl. The girl was 13 years old when she died, when she passed away when they were in Bangalore. And living away from Kerala, we were the first family members to him. So we all assembled and we went to the crematorium, cremated the child and came back. We stayed with him for almost 2-3 hours. We thought we'll give him at least 3-4 days time for him to recoup and come back. The second day he was there on the campus. Can you believe a person who lost his daughter, right, only daughter, and coming back to the institution? And when we asked him, in fact, I also scolded him, why did you come? Then he said, no, Vijay Kumar, I can't stay at home. I keep remembering my daughter. At least here I can see so many daughters, right? And that is the way that he has brought NLS as a family. And I can keep on speaking about him, and that's not my interest today because the occasion is entirely different. So we stand up and salute to this great soul, Dr. N.R. Madhav Menon, in whose name this parliamentary debate is being organized. I thank Professor Surya Prakash for having invited me to chair and be sharing my few thoughts about Dr. Menon before I say a few words about the debate per se. As a teacher of constitutional law and as a teacher both in political science and public administration, right, I have 3 masters. I have gone through the parliamentary procedure, debates, right? So what we see on, I don't know how many of you have been seeing the sessions of the parliament. It is very interesting, right? And one clipping of the Indian parliament proceeding went on and on in the global television channels, right, in the respective states for more than 30 days. It was nothing but the members fighting with each other, 2 groups throwing microphone. It was not the Indian parliament per se, but it was the UP state legislature, right? And every speaker, every member of legislative assembly, and I'm sorry, every honorable member of the legislative assembly had a microphone in front of their desk, right? So that whenever they stand up to address, you know, they don't have to walk up to the central podium to address. Now, when the heat started generating and the fight got initiated, there was no difference between ruling party or the treasury bench and the opposition parties. They all pulled the microphone from the table, started hurling at each other, and then at the fag end of that fight, all the microphones were removed from their respective benches or tables in whatever way you see. And then when it got reconvened, they passed a new rule in the UP legislature that there will be only 2 microphones in the legislature. One for the presiding officer and the other one will be kept in the well of the house. If anybody would like to speak, they will walk down to that microphone and speak. Now, whose loss is this? It is the loss of the honorable members, right? They lost the dignity, and instead of standing up and speaking from their own seats, they have to walk all the way down to the well and speak. And who has invited this? It is those honorable members themselves. And in the parliamentary debate, the heat will be generated and the heat should be generated, but you should know how to control that heat. And as students, don't emulate what you see on the television. I thought it was only the UP legislature as an example, and we have seen some of the parliamentary debates in Korea and other places where the fist fights were taking place all over, right? So you should understand that you have to bring what you call it as the dignity, the decorum, and the decency of the role one plays. And that should be the hallmark of your participation. And that is how you are going to be judged, right? And nothing less, nothing more. It is not simply wearing, I have attended some of the parliamentary debates, not in the classrooms, but where more than 200 participants will be sitting, but you will be participating as a team. You are given a role. They all come with an attire like a minister, like a political party, the Angavastra with the same colors, this, that, everything. That is not what is required. What is required is the way that you project yourselves, the way that you introduce a motion, the way that you counter a motion, which requires little bit of understanding of the subject matter, little bit of understanding of the phrases that are used in the legislature, little bit of patience in following the instructions given by the speaker from time to time, because if you don't do that, then possibly you may be thrown out of the house. Right, your time will be cut here and you will be penalized. You will not be thrown out, but literally you will be penalized for exceeding the commands that you receive. So these are the aspects that you have to keep in mind. And when you use the parliamentary phrases, right, you have to be very clear in understanding what is meant by those, the meaning of each and every phrase that you may use or you may come across. The second aspect that you have to remember is how best you can express yourself. It is not the subject knowledge. Sometimes many teachers, as students you would have seen, there are brilliant teachers, but when they come to the classroom, they don't know how to communicate, right? They are very brilliant, no doubt, or they commit lots of mistakes. So therefore, language in tune with this subject matter, the subject knowledge. A harmonious blend of these two. Not that you must be an expert only in English, not in subject matter, or you are only an expert in the subject matter, you do not know the language. Both are bad. It is an harmonious blend of the communication skill and the subject matter, which will take you to a greater level of participation as you proceed from one round to the next and to the final round. So don't emulate what you have seen on the television and perform the role. And when you have to say that you do not agree with the opposite side, right, you must be extraordinarily polite and courteous, right? You have to say, my learned friend, learned minister saying this, right? Not like Ram Jethmalani, when somebody said he was coming out of the court, he said, learned judge. So the lawyer, junior lawyer, asked him, sir, why did you use the term learned judge? The learned judge means that he doesn't know anything, right? That is why he is not able to understand things. That is why I use the term, not everywhere. In some places I use it because the judges have not understood what I was trying to say. So therefore, you must have little bit of wits. You must be little jovial. You cannot be 100% jovial to win over the hearts of the judges. Jovial to suit that occasion, right? Cut a joke, not at the expense of the opposite party, without hurting the feelings of each other. If you can cut a joke, that will be wonderful. Let me tell you, one here, one there will certainly make everyone laugh, and automatically the judges will give you one bonus point, right, over whatever they have given. I would like to make a mention about, I used to teach, as I told you, constitutional law. And the Keshav Singh's case, if you have read that case in detail, very interesting on parliamentary privileges. So we used to ridicule the parliamentary system that we are supposed to have adopted, which we have not done. So all these things we need to understand, we need to look at it. And on the lighter side of it, there were certain cartoons published against Nehru in the early 60s. So some of the members who were very close to Nehru, belonging to the political party, they went to him and asked him, showed him that journal, the newspaper, and said, see, this is what they have published, right? They have put your image like this and it is not correct, not appropriate. I would like to move a parliamentary, you know, privilege motion against the publication, right? And when it took place, when they did, on the floor of the house, some of them said, discussed with him, he said no. But somebody who did not meet him raised the issue straight away on the floor of the house. And you know the reply that he gave? The reply he gave was, the cartoons are to be laughed at. The cartoons are to be laughed at. That was in early 60s. So the parliament really had that disposition to understand, the willingness to accept, right? Somebody is having a laughter at my expense, wonderful, because I also have a laughter at somebody's expense, right? That understanding, that was something phenomenal. And down the line, 30 years down the line, or maybe in the early 90s or mid 90s, what happened in Tamil Nadu, I think the legislatures must put their heads down in shame, because when some cartoon was published in a Tamil magazine, right, even without following the principles of natural justice, the editor was asked to be arrested by the police, right? And the sentencing was also given without even being given an opportunity of being heard, right? That is the level to which we have gone. So therefore, cartoons are to be laughed. You can also make people laugh, but not at the expense of somebody else. And that golden line you should not cross. If you manage it, possibly you will be doing something very nice and you will also learn something interesting. Address the other side, the other members, with some dignity and decorum so that you can also expect the same thing from them, right? Ultimately, it is how best one can express, because you don't have time to think about. You have to be very smart in thinking and quick in responding, crack a joke, come back to the subject matter, and show your prowess of what best you have understood, right? If you have not understood, please don't project as if you have understood everything. That is also a weakness, right? So these are the few important aspects that you will play the role of two different teams, as it was explained to you. With these few words, I wish all the participating teams a very meaningful and learning experience, and all the very best to every team, participating team, including six international team. It will be really worth watching you on the TV, on the monitor that I have, but I have some other engagement. Maybe if it is recorded, I would like to sit and observe that little later, right? And I will also show it to our first year students when they come next year, so that it will inculcate some amount of education in their minds, that it is not only the classroom exercise, there are also other avenues available for them to learn. With these few words, I once again thank the Vice Chancellor of DSMLU, Dr. Surya Prakash, and his team for having given me this opportunity to speak to you this morning. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. We take immense pride in having you preside over this ceremony, sir. We're extremely grateful for your insight and the memories that you have shared with the visionary Dr. N.R. Madhava Menon himself. And on the note of gratitude, it brings us to the last segment of this opening ceremony. I request Ms. Soma B. to extend with an expression of our gratitude.
Thank you. I express my sincere gratitude, Vice Chancellor Sir, whose constant support and guidance we have counted and we have received whenever we needed it. Secondly, we are grateful to Professor Vijay Kumar Sir, who has agreed to become a chief guest with such a short notice. Thank you, sir. Thank you for being there. My sincere thanks to Registrar Sir and his office because of their continuous support. My deep appreciation to all the participating teams who will be there who has really encouraged us to go international and to organize this event. I also extend gratitude to IT department, who was constantly there for our support. And lastly, my solid team members who have worked day and night and made this event possible. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Vijay Kumar. Thank you.
Welcome. Welcome, Dr. Suri Prakash. Have a nice day. I can log off, no?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Well, Soma?
Yes, sir. Done. We are dot on time.
Oh, okay, right. Because there is curfew, you have to.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. We are also making a move.
Okay.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank and you. Wish you all the best.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Vani.
Thank you, Shreya. Your name was not visible there. It's a Shrivani Nair. Okay. Right.
Thank you, sir. Yes.
Right.